Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening. Thank you for downloading. And thank you for subscribing to the latest edition of the 12 Kyle podcast. I'm 12 Kyle. Check this out. On this episode of the podcast, we're going to take a look back. We're going to take you back to 1991, and we're going to break down the debut smash album from the R&B group Jodeci. They dropped a gem called Forever My Lady, and we're going to do an album review. And I've got a special co-host, my homegirl, Autumn the Aries. She's in the building. So sit tight, and we'll get the podcast jumping. Let's get it. Welcome back. As I mentioned in the intro, we have a special guest on this episode of the 12 Kyle podcast, and we're talking about the debut album from Jodeci, Forever My Lady. The album dropped in 1991, actually May 28th to be exact, 1991. And as you can see, I have a co-host. My co-host is one of my, and I'm not just saying this just because she's on here, this is one of my favorite podcasters. She's been in the game. She ain't been in the game that long, man, but she is really, really dope. Entrepreneur, podcaster herself, all around cool as the other side of the pillow. My homegirl, Autumn the Aries. Autumn, what's good?
What's good? I am so excited to be here. Like, it's one of my favorite podcasts. I feel like a stan.
Well, I appreciate it. I definitely appreciate it. As I mentioned in the intro, you haven't been podcasting that long, but you sound so much like a veteran. And like I said, not just blowing smoke, you're one of my favorite podcasters. Before we even get started, did you ever do like radio or anything? Like, because you have a what they call a radio voice.
It is so crazy that you asked me that, because it's probably been a week now. About a week ago, I was reminded that at one point in time, I wanted to be a sports broadcaster.
Okay.
Like, and it was like through a story or something that I was telling to somebody, because I'm always telling stories. But I was reminded that I really wanted to be a sports broadcaster. And I was looking into going to like broadcasting school and everything. And when I was in college, I worked for the radio station. So I was able to go to, it was like for two seasons long. So I was able to go to like all of the basketball games. Like I had a media pass. Okay. And I got to go. And I would go back to the radio station and just basically, it was like Rocket Report, report what happened at the game. So yes, like it literally just dawned on me almost a year after I made the podcasting that this is why I like it so much, because this is what I wanted to do at one point in time. So.
There you go. I meant to ask you that, and it never dawned on me. And I was like, I said, she just has what they call a radio voice. So it's funny to hear that. And that's, so what that means is she's dope because she's been cheating all this time.
Well, you know what? I am like utterly flattered by that, because I'll get on my podcast and I just be like, what are you even talking about? Like, why are you going rumbling on and on like this? Like, I don't feel it's like that. Well, that, 100% put together type of a broadcast, but I do it anyway because I can, because it's mine, right? And I pay for this equipment. So,
that's right.
So, but yeah, that's. Thank you. I really appreciate you saying that. Thank you.
No problem. No problem at all. As you guys who tuned in know, we're here to talk about a really, really dope album. I think one of the best albums from the 90s. In fact, it made my top 10 as far as one of the best albums from the 90s as far as R&B albums. Jodeci's debut album, Forever My Lady, as I mentioned, it dropped May 28th, 1991. So before we get started, let's take it back a little bit. Let's go back to 1991. Now, I'm not going to ask your age, Autumn, because
can I ask one question though?
Sure,
real quick.
Go ahead.
Where was this on your top 10? Because I forgot.
This one was, I think I had it at like 4 because I didn't. When we did the podcast, and for those of you who follow the podcast, me and my boy Eclectic, we did a podcast on the best R&B albums from the 90s. Eclectic put his as far as like he labeled his as far as 10 through 1. I didn't do that, but I think I had Jodeci at 4. My lady at 4. So I think that's where it comes in at. So, I think it's a phenomenal album, but I'm glad you asked that. Maybe I need to go back and rearrange it and kind of figure out, cause I just wrote them down. I didn't put them in any particular order. I know I had Brown Sugar at, number 1 for me. But yeah, so if we go back to 1991, like I said, I'm not going to ask your age.
I'll be 41 this year.
You're a few years younger than me. So I was actually in high school when this album came. I was actually a senior in high school. So I remember, a lot about what was going on around the time. So mm-hmm. Where were you musically? Like, what were you when this came out? Before you got a chance to hear it, do you remember kind of like what you were listening to around that time?
Oh man. You know what? I don't remember exactly. Maybe like, I don't know, maybe like around like Boys to Men,
yep,
type
boys, yep,
stuff.
Boys to Men yeah. Came out that year. Diamonds and Pearls came out.
Because I feel like there were H-Town. I feel like there were like 3 or 4 like black male bands or groups out at that time.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if New Edition had came out with one of their later ones.
I think they did. The Poison album came out, which was BBD. That came out in 1990. So New Edition hadn't gotten back together. But I think that in 91, the R&B albums, I remember Diamonds and Pearls from Prince.
Yeah.
Coolie High Harmony from Boys to Men. That was huge mm-hmm. in my high school. Mariah dropped Emotions.
Okay.
Let's see what else came out. Oh, Luther Vandross, Power of Love. I can't remember if that was Big Luther or Little Luther.
it might have been in between Luther right there.
Right. Right. Anyway, he was killing it. Another joint that I loved that year that came out was Michael Jackson's Dangerous.
Yes.
Very, very, one of my favorites from Michael Jackson. Teddy Riley crushed
I'm on there.
What's that?
Was Remember the Time on there?
Yep.
On that?
Sure was.
Let's see.
Sure was. What else came out? New Jack City soundtrack.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
The Boys in the Hood soundtrack. It was a pretty good year. It wasn't like a phenomenal year, but it was a pretty good year. Shawnee's came out with Inner Child. Mint Condition, Meant to Be Mint.
Yeah.
What else?
So much good music.
Yeah, it was. And another joint I used to play all the time. Phyllis Hyman's album. What was that joint called? Prime of My Life. Because I think that was released. Yeah, that was 91 too. So yeah, it was the music scene was pretty dope back then. So then again, like I said, the album comes out May 28th, 1991. So let's go back. Do you remember, where you were, the first time you heard a song or first time you saw a video or first, what I'm asking is, what were your first memories of Jodeci?
So it's funny because, I'm looking at this and it's saying that it was released May 28th, but I feel like I didn't really hear it or something until like right before school started.
Okay.
Because that next, you know, in the fall. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why, but I mean, of course, let's think about it. There was no internet, you know, you, right. You know what I'm saying? Like, you had to go buy the tape and, you know, if you didn't have it, somebody else may have had it, but when were you going to see them? You know, that type of deal. So, but my memory, my fondest memory, I remember it was like 6-7 o'clock at night. And I want to say, I almost want to say jukebox, but it may not have been the jukebox station. It might have been like MTV or VH1, something like that around that time. Mm-hmm. And I remember seeing the video. Remember seeing the video for Forever My Lady.
Was it BET?
It could have. Yeah, more than likely. It could have been. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I remember seeing the video. And I was like, oh my God. Like, oh my God, have you guys seen this? Like, I'm going down the street to my friend's house. I'm going around the corner. Like, oh my God, do you guys see it? I don't know. I have to figure out their names, but the light skin one. Y'all know what I'm talking about. He don't be singing, but whatever. So I remember that. And then I remember the very next day going to school. So I remember I was in, I think, seventh grade. Mm-hmm. I remember, like, walking to the bus stop. I remember getting on the bus and going to the back of the bus because, you know, that's what we do still. Right. and the guys in the back of the bus singing Forever My Lady. Wow. Like, like almost all the way to school. Like, this was everybody. And, like, from that point on, I was just in love with them. Like, I remember it was like one of the best feelings ever. Couldn't wait to get the tape. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, oh my God, I have to get this tape. I don't know if I got it. I can't remember if I got it like right away, but I do remember having it. And it's crazy.
Wow. So you were on the bus and you saw the video and then guys on the bus singing. Wow, that's impressive. Yeah. That is really impressive.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. I know. I remember I bought the tape, but it wasn't a situation where I bought the tape like the first day that it came out. Because I don't think anybody, like you said, there was no internet. So for those of you who are a little bit younger than us, who aren't as seasoned as us, you know, we had this thing called a tape, and you put it in a tape deck, right, and you play it. So. And here's the funny thing. There was a rewind button and there was a fast forward button. But for the most part, you just had to kind of sit there and listen to the tape. So
yep.
I remember one of my boys told me that he was like, yo, you need to check out that Jodeci. And I was like, okay, well, who is Jodeci? Because I didn't know, you know, because like I said, the album came out in May. I want to say I got the tape probably that summer. So I got it maybe a month or two before you did. I remember I just got it really on the strength of my boy because he said it was dope. And, you know, we were big, big music fans. So, you know, word of mouth back then, word of mouth meant everything. So if somebody said that something was dope, you were definitely going to check it out, particularly if you know, respected their opinion. So when my boy told me, he had it and it was dope. He was like, you need to get it. I was like, okay, cool. And first, let me back up. I asked him for a dub. of his tape.
Every time.
And he was like, nah, man, you got to go buy it yourself. And I was like, man, come on, man. Because, you know, I mean, it's, you know, tapes were like $7. That was a lot of money back in the day when you had the money. So nonetheless, I remember it because I was just about to graduate from high school. Like I said, it came out May. I graduated June of 1991. So that summer, I remember getting it because we had a pool party at my house. And I remember playing it at the pool. It was like not long after graduation. So sometime in that summer, I do remember playing it at the pool party. So, it was crazy. I just remember that time. And it was, music was, like you said, it was different because this music just had a certain feel. And then I think one of the things that was impressive about Jodeci was that they had a certain look. Now, I do remember them, and you may or may not remember this, but the first time that I saw them, I didn't know who they were. They were singing background on Father MC's. Yeah, there you go. Treat them like they want to be treated. But I didn't know who they were. And so that was the first time that I saw them. But the first time that I actually copped the tape was probably sometime in June of 1991.
And how dope was Father MC? Like, that whole little clique was just, oh my God, like that whole, all of them,
I know, right? So yeah, music was, like I said, it was so much different back then. So I'm thinking like, okay, so you got the tape, like you said, when school started. What are your first, do you have any memories of like, you know, listening to it the first couple of times and maybe what you thought or maybe what, you know, kind of stood out? Anything that, you know, kind of brings back those memories when you listen to it?
Yeah, I mean, so again, keep in mind, I was in seventh grade. So, you know.
So should you have really been listening to this music, Autumn?
Probably not. But nevertheless, listening to it, and you have crushes. You know what I'm saying? At that age, you have crushes, or maybe you have a boyfriend or a girlfriend. You know, maybe so you're feeling. You know, those were the years when you were really feeling. Like, you don't know what you were feeling. And it was probably 100% all wrong.
Puppy love?
Yeah. But you were definitely feeling something. So listening to, you know, this particular album at 12, and also, 12, 13.
Right.
Also, my sister, I have an older sister. My sister is 9 years older than me.
Okay.
So it was kind of easy to gravitate toward it, I guess you could say, because I was already listening to stuff that my sister was listening to. Mm. You see what I'm saying? I was already like in that groove. But I just remember listening to it and just wanting to feel what they felt. And that's one thing that, you know, yeah, I was young then, but even now, like, to listen to a love song, like, in order for me to say that it's good, it's like, I want to be able to feel what you are feeling in this song. So that's what it was for them. Like, for me, in regards to Jodeci, it was just like, they sang. You couldn't help. you could have got to the fast song. You know what I'm saying? You about to dance because you couldn't help like the vibration of their song and of their songs and the words. It was just like it was awesome. Like what's his name? Not Devontae, but Dalvin. Mm-hmm. You know, Dalvin wrote the majority of those songs on there, and he was an excellent writer. Right. Like, it was just amazing. I don't know. Sometimes I can't put it into words how happy it made me feel. Even again at 12, 13 years old, I don't really know what love is, but I wanted to feel whatever what was they feeling. I was singing at the top of my lungs like I was feeling it too, but that's the type of music that it was. Mm-hmm. It made you feel, and that's what I loved about it.
I tell people all the time, like, it's this era produced a lot of great feel-good music. And I mean, and I don't mean that, you know, I mean that literally and figuratively. Like, you can just, you can listen to this music and it takes you and puts you in a certain place. It's interesting listening to you talk about that, because you were so much younger, haven't, you know, I mean, I'm assuming in seventh grade, you probably hadn't had your first, you know, real crush boyfriend / I'm going to, you know, love him for the rest of my life type guy.
Right.
And, you know, me being this, you know, high school senior, soon to be college bound freshman, you know, I had experienced a few things.
Right. Okay.
So this album, I totally agree with you. It resonated with me in a way that, you know, not really a lot of albums did, but I think at this particular time, what I was going through as far as the transitioning from high school to college, and then also, you know, having been in relationships and, you know, telling girls I loved them when I really didn't. But that's another story. But
but you were talking about their look. Like, were you like dressing like them at
no,
that point?
No, I didn't. Now, and Autumn is making a great point. So for those of you who weren't around in 1991,
you know what I'm bringing up. You know what I'm. Okay, go ahead.
Jodeci had this look, right? And for those of you who weren't around in 1991, don't feel bad because your parents just hadn't met yet. So they had this look where it was, they would be, I guess, like if you look at the Forever My Lady video, right? They're in these long jackets and, you know, it's like a casual look, but then they got on these combat boots and then they got on these baseball caps. So it's like a mixture. If you're looking at them, it's kind of hard to describe what they look like, but as far as style is concerned, but it was a little bit of hip hop.
They definitely had their own.
Exactly. They had their own style and everything. So to answer your question, no, I didn't dress like that. I did want me one of those coats. Matter of fact, my mom got me a purple. I don't know why the hell I needed a purple coat. But she got me a purple coat like they had in the video.
Wait a minute, because your aunt or your grandma got you a purple sweater or something at one point in time, did she?
My mom got me a purple turtleneck for Christmas, man.
That's what it was, turtleneck.
Never would have. She was probably still in a box somewhere back home.
you mean to tell me, because we have to do this part of their style, we have to do it justice. Mm-hmm. You mean to tell me, because you mentioned these combat boots, but we can't do it like that. They were Jodeci boots.
I mean, if that's what you want to call them.
Y'all didn't call them that? That's what everybody where I was from called them.
You know what's cool is that you're from the Midwest, right? You're from Ohio.
Yes. I'm from Ohio, yep.
And so I'm from South Carolina. So we just call them combat boots. So it's interesting to hear. So how was it described to you guys? Or how did you relate as far as to their style as far as what you said?
So, okay. For me, I was kind of tomboyish. I could never really pull off the tomboy thing because I was just way too girly, I guess. But I still dressed like the brat. Like I kind of dressed like the brat. With a little taste of like Aaliyah, and you know what I'm saying. It was kind of those type of. So these Jodeci boots, like. I needed everything. There were different colors, guys. Like, I needed every single color. Like, I needed the black. I needed the purple. I needed the red. I needed the yellow. Now, I needed all of them. I ain't get them all.
Okay. That was going to be my next question.
I had the black ones. I had some blue ones. Wow. And I had some clear ones, which were just, like, why? Like, why? But
I was gonna ask why.
So me and my best friend Shantae, like, we always, you know why, you know, we had access because her people was like boosters, so it wasn't like we was paying, we had to pay full price.
Makes
you know
sense.
What I'm saying?
Makes
so
sense. You got the hook up.
Yeah, right, we had the hook up. So but that it was huge. So, you know, I kind of wore like baggy clothes, you know, stuff like that. So the Jodeci boots went perfect, you know what I'm saying, with the baggy clothes. And then there were guys who had them, but I just, for some reason, I feel like it was like more girls, I don't know. And then, like, you know, at one point in time, they had like all of their stuff was like overly big, but they had that big old like clear suit, kind of like the one that picture of Omarion or whoever that is going around. They got some clear suits on. I think Jodeci might have done that first.
They did.
Because I remember them doing that. So, yeah, I mean, I guess so. I think so. I think we took to it pretty big up there.
Wow, that is interesting. I want to say, from what I could recall, because again, like I said, when the album first came out, I was, you know, transitioning between high school and college. And even when I got to college, I don't remember anybody dressing like Jodeci, but I do remember guys having those boots, but never, you know, like you go to a party or something like that and people just dress like them. But it was, I guess the best thing that I can say for those who weren't around was that this style that Autumn is describing became very, very popular. And it also helped their popularity because not only were they singing, but at first glance, you really didn't know what to make of them because they kind of looked hip hop, but they were crooners. They were guys who were just going to sing. They weren't thugged out or anything like that. Once you got a chance to, you know, hear them in an interview or something like that, they were, you know, they just regular down home Southern boys, if you will. But they were singers, but they didn't look like singers because all before leading up to this time, you know, record labels and executives made sure that, you know, the artists kind of looked like the music that they were doing, you know, so New Edition looked like New Edition. They looked like kids when as they matured, they, you know, they had them look like kids their age, if you will. But I think that was one of the things that was key about Jodeci was that they weren't from the street, but they looked street and then they had street appeal.
Yep. They did. They had street appeal and they had sex appeal. Mm-hmm. I mean, it just is what it is. Like, well, if you threw Jodeci on in the car when you went to go pick your bae up, mm-hmm. and you had Jodeci on, you already knew. Right. This is how you know. You know, right. What I'm saying? Like, you already knew what move was being set.
Right.
So, and another thing too about Jodeci, you know, sometimes you have groups who it seems like there's just people in it. Like, you have just maybe one really good singer and then the rest are just there because they needed a group. And Jodeci was not like that. And I know it's like so many people never really understood Mr. Dalvin's presence, but he definitely had a presence. You know what I'm saying? Like, they all four of them played a very big part in that group. Like, I don't feel like any of them could have been replaced. No. You see what I'm saying? Like, and which is probably why we've never seen, you know, they've, you know, broken up and gone their separate ways, got back together and all that stuff. But you've never seen a substitute in any one of their places because it just wouldn't make sense.
No, not at all. And for those of you scoring at home, Jodeci, and I probably should have mentioned this at the beginning, but Jodeci is a collection of two sets of brothers. You have Casey and JoJo, who are brothers, and Dalvin and Devontae, who are brothers. And they're from Monroe, North Carolina, which is right outside of Charlotte. But you're right. I think everybody did something. I think, you know, Devontae did most of the writing for this album and most of the writing for Jodeci, period.
I thought Dalvin was the one that was writing and Devontae was the one that was like producing.
No, Devontae did most of the writing and producing. Dalvin did, I think he did more the production as far as musically, with like some of the programming and stuff like that, with the drums and stuff like that. They didn't use any live instruments, but I think he's credited with playing some instruments on not only this album but their subsequent albums. But he also handled the business side of Jodeci as well. And then of course Casey and JoJo were the, you know, the lead singers, if you will. So everybody had a role and everybody kind of played their role and nobody, you know, really at least from the outside looking in, it didn't look like there was a power struggle, because you know how it is sometimes with groups. Mm-hmm. There's a power struggle as to, you know, I'm going to go solo or I can do my thing or whatever the case may be. But yeah, it was a cohesive unit. And Jodeci, like I said, they, you know, seemingly came out of nowhere in 1991. And this album was, you know, an incredible album. As I mentioned in the intro, I mean, like, this album comes out and it blows everybody away. I want to say this album went triple platinum, which in 1991 for a group, R&B male group, was unheard of. The first single that they released was Forever My Lady, and that came out in August of 1991. So that was right around the time that you were getting ready to go to school. So yeah, when I talk about the production, as I mentioned that, you know, most of the production, well, actually the, like I said, the, what was written, you know, Devontae did all of that. Devontae and a guy by the name of Albert Brown. And you guys may know him as Al B. Shore. Devontae actually is credited for writing all of the songs, and they're produced. I think he produced all of them with, he produced, let me see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 songs with Al B. Shore. In fact, Al B. Shore helped co-write Forever My Lady, and he wrote Forever My Lady for his then girlfriend at the time, Kim Porter, the late Kim Porter, who has a child with Al B. Shore. And of course, she would go on to have, I think she had a couple of kids with Puff before she passed away, I think 2 years ago. But nevertheless, this album was, to say it was well received is an understatement. Like I said, it went triple platinum. Everybody had it. I mean, almost everybody I knew had it. And it was getting major airplay. So do you have any memories of, like, you know, it being played on the radio, or maybe, you know, being played by your friends, and, you know, what was their reaction when, you know, when the music was being played?
Well, I primarily remember, you know, because back then we could call into the radio and request.
Of course,
you know, we always would call and request, you know, Forever My Lady and Stay. And I know we gonna get into the breakdown of the song later, but when Come and Talk to Me came, I mean, it's just the excitement every single time. Like, even when you had the tape, okay, you had the tape, you've listened to the tape I don't know how many times, but you get in the car and one of these songs come on the radio and you just can't contain yourself because it's such a great song. I just, this whole CD or tape, this whole tape was, I mean, both A side and B side, because, you know, back then we had B side tracks.
Right.
So even the B side got me. You know what I'm saying? So for me in particular, I was very, very, I don't know if I could maybe say engulfed in it. Like, I loved this. That's why when you tweeted it or you said you were going to do this, I was like, oh no, you got to get me on there for this one. I've been listening to it all day. I'm hyped. I'm like, oh yeah, we about to break all of these down. Okay, yes, let's do this. So, but yeah, I can remember, because again, like I said, I was in seventh grade, but I used to go to, it's crazy because my hometown had this place called, it was a couple of different places, Jago's and Henry J. And they had a like teen night. Like Henry J's was an actual like bar, but they had a teen night that, you know, if you were like 13 and up, you could go or whatever. So I can remember it being played there. You see what I'm saying? Like, I can remember, yeah, like it was, I mean, I probably, again, I was young. I probably should have understood or felt anything, but I did. And it stuck with me all these years because I have the almost exact, you know, feelings and reactions to it now. It's probably even better now, you know, because I understand it. You know what I'm saying? So,
oh, no doubt. It's funny just to hear you know, speak with such clarity about this. And I just kind of have to remind myself that, yeah, you probably were too young to be. And it's not like it's graphic because. And we'll get into it, you know, when we break down the tracks. But it's not like it's graphic, but it's just like, you know, hearing people sing about, you know, love and having babies and, you know, sex or whatever the case may be, I would think that the subject matter would be flying over your head. But you seem to be pretty in tune with it, though.
I was, but too, also, I, again, I've carried this music along with me.
Yes.
So I can remember, you know, at my early 20s listening to it. You see what I'm saying? Like, I can remember my early 20s and feeling these feelings, you know, I mean, because it's timeless music for me.
It is.
You know? So I knew I already in my early 20s, I had music that I could basically relate any situation to. And I, you know, had that stuff in my collection. So when it was time for me to listen to Jodeci, it was time for me to listen to Jodeci. So that's probably, you know, a lot of like where the clarity for me came from.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, because like I said, you know, seventh grade, yeah, you know, puppy love, of course, you're feeling the song some type of way, but it's probably not the way that it was intended for you to feel, you know what I'm saying? Like, you're just, it's all going over your head. So, but yeah, again, like today, I feel some type of way about this whole CD. Mm.
Yes. Yeah, I mean,
like
you said, it's timeless.
It is
timeless. It is a great, it represents a great period of time. And it was, like I said, just an incredible album. I tell you what, that's a perfect place. We could take a quick commercial break. We'll hear from Jodeci. And on the other side of the break, we're going to break it down. I'm going to pick Autumn's brain. We'll talk about some of the tracks, maybe some tracks that she really, really loved, maybe some tracks she didn't like or whatever the case may be. And we'll just kind of get into it and like I said, and just break it down. So sit tight. We'll be back in just a sec.
Devontae, I heard that you had worked with Al B. Sure on producing or something like that.
Yes, I did like a couple of songs on this album. You know, he did some stuff on our album as well. You know, I'm working with him now, so, you know, he's a good friend.
Yeah, okay. And I also want to know, what was the inspiration for Forever My Lady?
We love ladies, and we think, you know, let me get on that. Okay, a lot of groups, you know, they write about making love, but they never write about having a baby and taking care of a baby. You know, we love ladies so much that we just, you know, we think we ought to take care of them, you know. And, you know, we have mothers, and, you know, we see all this stuff happening. So we just touched on that, you know, because another group has done that, so...
Good answer. I like that.
And just like that, we are back. Once again, it's your boy, 12 Kyle. This is the 12 Kyle podcast. And we're talking about Jodeci's debut album, Forever My Lady. I got my girl Autumn the Aries on. As I mentioned before the break, you know, we're going to talk about the tracks, you know, talk about what we like, what we didn't like, whatever the case was. So let's start right there. Track number one.
But hold on real quick.
Go ahead.
1 second. So this summer, so you know that I you know, run now. I'm like this runner or whatever. So I run several of my runs. I just have to make sure people understand how much I love this album. Several of my runs, several, I have listened to this CD, or I keep saying CD, this project, whatever you want to call it.
It's an album.
Yeah, this album during my run. That's how much I like it. I just had to get that off my chest.
Oh, no. But that, you know, that, but that speaks to, you know, how music resonates. And I think, you know, sometimes people kind of forget how music really resonates with us. When it resonates with you and there's a connection, it stays with you. Like, you don't, you know, you don't ever stop listening to, you know, whatever the song is or whatever the album is that, you know, means something to you. It's particularly if it's good. And, you know, as
right.
I mentioned at the top, like, you know, so much good music came out during this era. You know, it's hard to say, okay, well, hey, these were my formative years, and I'm just going to bypass the music that came out that time. No, it doesn't work like that.
No.
That music, that music tends to grow with us and grow as we grow. So I feel you. No, you should be listening to this album. I still listen to it a lot because it's a really, really dope album. So yeah, we can start right there with track one, Stay. Like I said, written by, produced by Albie Shore and Devontae Swing. They did a video for it. This was actually the third song to be released on the album. What did you think about Stay?
When the video came on.
You know it's hype when people, when they sigh before they start talking.
Oh, man. The video came on and it was Devontae right then and there. They didn't give you no chance to get your footing or nothing. It was just Devontae come on there talking. It's just like, and then they just come in with that whole harmony when they say stay right then and there. Right. It was just so perfect. It was so freaking perfect. Like, who's leaving?
Right.
who's leaving after that song? Even if you're not them singing it. Right. Like, if you play that, you messed up and you play that song, nobody's leaving. Period.
This is true. You can't go. So, you gotta stay.
You have to. And Casey and JoJo, but Casey mainly, I mean, he told the story. Every note that he sang, like he sang. He wasn't a singer. He sang. So, I mean, you felt every single word all the way through the end, which for most of their songs, they have that ending that just keeps going. Mm-hmm. Like, the song could literally keep going. It's like they cut them off because they're still really, 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 really singing, right?
Mm-hmm. yes.
I mean, to the very last second of the song.
Yes.
It's like they pulled the plug. Like, y'all
I'm like, okay, we got to cut this off.
So, yes, they was the bomb. I mean, it was the video was well put together. I think that was that wasn't on the Desert Den too, were they?
No, that was the other. I think that was Come and Talk to Me. Forever My
Lady. Oh,
or maybe it was Forever My Lady. I don't know.
I think it was Forever My Lady. But either way it goes, it was good.
Yeah, I concur with everything that you just said. I think If you listen to the podcast, like I this song is like one of my favorite songs, and this song has, you know, ended up on every Slow Jams Get the Draws tape that I've ever made.
I've seen you.
I mean, because again, it says the mood. You got to stay. You, like you said, after you listen to this, who's going anywhere?
Nobody.
I do remember. One of the, like, and you kind of took me back a little earlier with the when you could call into the radio station and dedicate a song. I do remember somebody calling into the radio station and dedicating, and it's weird because they called in and they dedicated this song to me, but I didn't hear the name.
Oh.
And so to this day, I don't know who did it.
Wow.
And I know it's me because there weren't many Kyles in my hometown. So
right.
And not no black Kyles for that, but there probably wasn't no black Kyles in my hometown but me. So, and that was like, what, summer? I think summer 91, somewhere like that. So yeah, it was, but not, seriously, this song is everything. Like I said, it's my favorite song on the album. It's a song that, like, you know, when you listen to it, you almost just have to kind of just stop and just stop what you're doing and just kind of take it in. And I still love it to this day, man. It'll always be my jam on this album. But yeah,
that's your favorite song on the album?
Yes, hands down, not even close. Favorite song on the album. So, and I mean, get right to it. Don't talk, just listen.
Right?
I mean, it didn't get any better than that. That's how they start the album off. Don't talk, just listen.
He started it and then started with that apology. It's just right.
Sorry I left you crying. I mean, come on.
Come on.
Come on, man. What are we doing here?
That boy said, since you've been gone, I've been all alone. Right. Like, okay.
So,
okay.
I mean, so, you know, you got her right there.
Right there, like the first 25 seconds of the right. song. Yeah. You had me. You had me. Okay, he said, don't talk, just listen. Then you get the, you know, you get that part. And he's talking. But when they say stay, when they come with that harmony,
we
ain't even got to the song. Exactly. I'm already there.
Exactly. You ain't going nowhere.
and I'm probably butt naked. So that's it. It is what it is right there. What else are we doing?
Right. Like I said, and thus the reason why it ended up on every Slow Jams Get the Draws tape. track two, Come and Talk to Me. Again, produced by Devontae Swing and I'll Be Sure.
What the remix?
Okay.
But
I'm going to do you like I did Eclectic. You going with the original or the remix?
I'm going with the remix.
Okay.
I'm going with the remix. And I typically do not, but I'm going with the remix on this one.
The remix is so cold. It is so, so
cold. It's so cold. I mean, you have to. Do you know anybody that would pick the original? And don't get me wrong.
The original is dope. Right. So yeah, I'm with you. I gotta go with the remix. Come and Talk to Me, man. This song was also released. This was actually the fourth single that was released. It was released after Stay. I don't even know where really to start, man.
KC was
killing it. I mean,
he killed it. He killed it. And even with the whole change in melody of the song and Devontae on the, I think that might have been Devontae on the piano. Like, I just, like, who did that? Who put this together? It was a masterpiece. Mm-hmm. It was a masterpiece.
Yeah, I agree. And it's one of those songs that it's a mood changer. Like,
yes.
It doesn't matter where you are or what you're doing. And, you know, this is what a ballad sound. I guess you really could say it for all of these songs on here, but this is what ballads sounded like in the 90s, you know.
And think back to a time when you were in a club and it dropped. DJ put that on there because that's when we play slow songs.
Right. You could get away with playing a slow song in the club because it was your chance to slow drag.
And I remember graduating from high school and went to this, they used to have these parties down at one of this school or whatever. I can't even really remember. But what I do remember is them playing the Come and Talk to Me remix at that party because, again, it was... We play slow music back then. You had at least three or four slow songs before the fast song.
Talk to them. Talk to them.
So just the mood, like you said, it was a total mood changer. Like you literally could have been listening to Luke and then, you know, and the Two Live Crew. And then, you know what I'm saying? They dropped Jodeci and it was still the jam then. And that was years later for me.
Oh, no doubt. No doubt. I agree 1,000%. Again, dope ass ballad. So you go. So I'm just setting the stage here for those of you listening. The first two songs, dope ballads. Then they come with the aforementioned Forever My Lady track three. Like I said, it was produced and written by Devontae Swing and I'll Be Sure. So this was the first sync. Well, actually, this is the second single. It says here that the first single that was released was Gotta Love, but I'll be honest, I don't remember Gotta Love being released as a single.
I don't either.
And it says here that it was released in February of 1991, so that means it would have come out a few months before the album. I don't remember that.
I don't even remember seeing them perform it anywhere. Like I don't remember Gotta Love until I actually had the album.
Same here, Autumn. Same here. So yeah, Forever My Lady comes out, the video comes out, they're crushing it, they're killing it. I mean, this is the jam everywhere. It's on BET, it's on Black Radio.
And again, they come out the gate.
Yes.
So you're having my baby. I am. You're right. You are absolutely right. I am.
Right. And trust me, that says a lot for a guy to say that. And he's cool with it. So you're having my baby. And it means so much to me.
So much. So much.
There's
nothing
more precious than to raise a family.
And again, you have KC. See, and JoJo too. I'm not trying to discredit.
No, but KC did kill it.
But KC was, if he wasn't in love on every single love song that Jodeci had, he's a very good performer, because you had to feel it when KC started to sing.
Yes.
Had to.
Yes. He like you said, and I think one thing that really stands out in this, in listening to this album, as far as, you know, both he and JoJo, you can hear their, I guess, their history as far as in their voices. You can tell that they grew up singing in the church, because they sound like it. They sound like I said, Southern boys who grew up singing in the church. And if I'm not mistaken, they're parents were like, maybe one of their parents was a pastor or something like that, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, so again, they come with Stay, Come and Talk to Me, Forever My Lady, then track four, they hit you with another ballad, I'm Still Waiting.
And we're gonna stop there.
We're
gonna stop there, because this I have a playlist on Spotify called Repeat Worthy. This is my favorite song from this album. This is my favorite song from this album. I mean, the way again, it's another begging song. He begging again.
Okay.
Because that's what they did back then. And it's just like, he can't wait any longer.
Nope.
He cannot wait. This song brings me to tears. If I haven't heard it in, you know, a couple of months, when I do hear it, it literally breaks me down. Because he feels, it's like he feels. So I know I'm so whack for that, but it literally is what it is. And I don't know if I've ever felt that way, or if anybody has ever felt that way about me, but it damn sure feels like it, because when he sings, I mean, I don't know, it's my favorite. It is my favorite off of this album.
Okay.
I can literally, I know I've said that like 25 times. Like, I could put it on repeat and it tonight and wake up and still be singing it. Seriously.
Wow. I was thinking in my head, like, kind of guessing as to what might be your favorite song. I didn't guess this. I was guessing Forever My Lady, but okay. I'm still waiting. This song is so dope.
For you to come back to home to fulfill this life.
Yes.
I am still waiting. I'm not giving up. Okay, I know you might have needed your space. I messed up again, so I understand. But this time, I'm just gonna wait here. I've been waiting too long, but I'm still waiting. And he sang the hell out of that song.
He killed it. Oh my god, he killed it. And what my favorite part, when he says, so let's start all over and put the past behind.
Yeah.
I mean, like, if you've been in relationships, or you, whatever the case may be, you know, whether or not it was your man or your girl or whoever, you know, when you've had that, when you messed it up, or maybe if they messed it up and you just want to try it again, this song is perfect, right? And I think, you know, what he was conveying and what he was singing was just like, it hit home for a lot of people. So I know like mad people who did, like you said, this was their favorite song because it resonates and there's a connection there. So I totally get it.
And one thing that I also loved about them, and I think they kind of kept this sort of, I don't know if you want to call it a cadence or not, but in the very beginning of the song, and I think this is what really makes these songs, in the very beginning of the song, he's very calm. Like, have you ever noticed that? Mm-hmm. He's very, very mm-hmm. calm. That first time when he starts to say, when he starts with the chorus, "I'm just waiting for you to come back to love." It's almost just like I'm speaking it. Very, mm-hmm. very calm. And as the song goes on, because he's feeling this, like it's, yes. it's like a spirit. And he's feeling it, and it just escalates, and it just goes up and up, and not only is it going up and up and up, but it gets better.
Mm-hmm. It does. And
it's like you feel his heart. People don't sing like this no more.
No, they don't.
Sing like this anymore.
It's about I want to get you in bed and do dirty things to you.
and crack. Like, all of that. You put all that in there. Like, even the people that have voices, it just doesn't compare to this. This really moved you. It just, you know, like you said, if it was relatable, like, if you could relate to it, oh, man.
And you know what? You know what I really love, too, is the chick speaking Spanish on the beginning. I still, yes. to this day, I don't know what the hell she said, but it sounds dope as hell.
What the hell she said.
And you know, I don't even know if it's Spanish. It might be French for all I know.
That's on you and I. That's on you and I.
Okay.
But I get it. Yep.
I'm a track ahead. So next track, You and I. Mm-hmm. Like I said, she comes in speaking whatever that is she's speaking. And again, to your point, you know, it starts off very slow and it's, mm-hmm. I guess, and you know, it's funny. I never really paid attention to you just till you just said it, but maybe they did that on purpose to kind of start off conversational. And then as he starts to sing more and more, you get more emotion coming out. So he's vocally louder, not really louder, but he's louder as far as, you know, trying to convey what he's feeling. But
a lot more passion.
Yeah, You and I, another banger. Oh my gosh, another banger. This song goes so hard. It goes so hard.
How many albums can you say that you know of that the first five tracks are 100% solid?
None. And that was what was weird about the, I don't mean weird in a negative way, but that's what was different and interesting about this album is because, like you said, the first five songs are all ballads. And I'm sure back in the 70s or maybe in the 80s, there were albums that were set up like this. But as Autumn mentioned earlier, we got this on a tape, right? So there's an A side and then there's a B side. So the A side was all ballads. The B side was all up tempo songs. So I personally had never seen or heard anything like that. And this album is so cold that even when you get to the B side, you're like, okay, I'm feeling this. Like, it wasn't like you were like, okay, I'm going to spend all day on the A side. You really wanted to sit and listen and let this album sit with you that whole time. But this was phenomenal, given the fact that they put five ballads, and for the most part, all of these ballads at one point in time or another were on the charts. Crazy.
And you said, yes, you could literally, you're going to sit. It's like the first five are so good. You coast right into the up-tempo stuff. And not only is it up tempo, it's happy,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
It's happy music, happy feel good music. So it was very easy to, you know, if you was fancy and you had that tape recorder that automatically
flipped,
You know what I'm saying? If you was rich,
I wouldn't fancy.
And you had the component set that did it. You know what I'm saying? So then it was easy to do. It was very, very easy to do. Also, you know, it took a lot to, not a lot, but it took a little time to rewind the tape. So, yes. You know, you're just going to turn it over.
Exactly. Yeah. Point taken. You had to just flip it over and just listen. And it was worth the listen on the other side. So then we go to track 6, which is Interlude 553 Nasty.
Which is actually fire, too.
Yeah. Oh, no question. No, it's only a minute and 47 seconds, but it's a dope interlude. And then you get into the first jam of the B side, My Phone, track 7. My phone doesn't ring anymore. Now, if that ain't something in the 90s, I don't know what is. When you say my phone don't ring anymore.
My phone do not ring anymore. And it was a nice little up-tempo, a little bop.
Really,
you could bop your head, too.
I really liked it. That song still... like I said, I thought it was a really, really good start for the B side. I found it, again, it's interesting that they didn't release any of these faster songs as far as, you know, singles, but they didn't necessarily have to, because by the time they hit you with the 5 on the front side, you know, you didn't need any more Jodeci. Everybody had it. So.
And notice, you know, back then, and it's true with this album too, the singles came out so far in between each other. Like, you're still listening. Mm-hmm. In 1991, it came out in 1991, but in 1992, it's almost like it's brand new all over again, because mm-hmm. they're still releasing singles.
Yep.
So... you know, it was easy to carry with you, like at that time. That's why it seemed like music lasts way longer back then.
Yeah, because we allowed it to. I mean, to your point, Stay was released in December of 1991, and then Come and Talk to Me was released in March of 1992, and this album dropped in May. So, yeah, exactly. So this album dropped in May of 1991. So it's almost been a year. And then I'm Still Waiting is released as a single in August of 1992. So it had already been a full year. And when you're dropping you're still dropping singles and being released to radio and everything. So it was that speaks volumes as to, you know, the longevity of the album and just why it resonates with so many people. Then you go to track 8, Gotta Love. Which was actually written by Devontae and KC, produced by Devontae Swing. Again, I thought KC killed it.
He did. He most definitely did. Even that's funny. Even on the fast songs, like he killed it.
Yeah, he doesn't sign. Both he and JoJo, but KC more in particular. It doesn't really matter if he's on a fast track or a slow track. He's going to give you something.
Yeah.
And, you know, it goes back to something you said a little earlier. There's a difference between singers and sangers.
Absolutely.
And he can sing.
Right. And even with songs like Gotta Love, it was kind of like that New Jack Swing type of song. Mm-hmm. So we danced to, like, I remember it coming out as a single, but I do remember like having a quote unquote step to it. You know what I'm saying? We had a dance step to it.
Mm-hmm.
So because most of the New Jack songs, you know, we really, really danced to, like, not dance with each other, but like dance as a group, you know, learn the whole routine and, you know, the block party or whatever and set it off. So this was one of those songs. Like, Gotta Love was one of those songs that, you know, it was fun. It was entertaining. I sit here and think, I was thinking earlier too, like, how many times you listen to like these albums and you think you know the whole song, but you really don't know the whole song.
Right.
You're singing it like, wait a minute, what do they say right there? Like, I've been saying such all these years, or you ain't been saying nothing, and you realize, like, I was going through that listening to this earlier. So yeah, it's like, but it was a fun up-tempo song, and we had those back then, and they weren't, you know, we didn't skip those songs. Mm-hmm. I know, like, a lot of people talk about skips and stuff now on albums, but, like, especially for this album, we didn't really skip that stuff because we liked the up-tempo and we liked to dance to it, so.
And then we had tapes, too, so, you know, you really weren't going, like you said, unless you were rich and you wanted to just waste your time just rewinding and staying on side A,
right.
You probably were going to play the whole tape. And I think yep. back then music came out in such volumes to where, and such great quality to the where you didn't mind, or I don't want to say all, but a lot of, the majority of the albums that came out back then, they were so good that, you know, even if you flipped to the B-side and maybe there were a couple of songs that you really didn't rock with, they were good enough for you to sit through and listen either way.
Yep.
You know, they might not have been your favorite, but it's still, like you said, still a little bop, still something for you to jam to, and you still could appreciate it. And
right.
I think that's, you know, hugely different between, you know, then and now.
But did you have a repeat tape, though? Did you have a tape that you had one song on there that you just recorded over and over?
I didn't, but one of my boys, he did. He had a tape with just Stay on it, and that was no, it.
I can believe that. I can believe it.
And he told me about it, and I was like, "Where?" He's like, "Yeah." He's like, "I just want to have that." Stay was on. If the tape was 60 minutes, he had 60 minutes of just Stay. That was it.
Right. Yeah. And people did that all the time.
Yeah, and you took me back with that because people used to do that. I never did it just because I value my tape space. So I figured, you know, I knew I could get so many songs on a particular side of a tape. But yeah, it was, and people would do that for this particular album, you know, particular songs off this album. So,
I don't think I had one of those either, but I remember like a friend having one. So. Mm-hmm.
Cause when my boy told me he did it, I was like, why? He was like, hey, man.
Like, how much time did it? I mean, it literally took, you know, over an hour to do if it was exactly. a 60-minute Memorex exactly. or whatever.
Shout out to the Memorex.
Even when you, shout out to Memorex and shout out to that number 2 pencil.
Yes, like, yes. Gotta have it. You gotta have it. So then we go to track 9, Plaything. Another good up-tempo joint. I mean, it. They didn't miss a beat with this. I don't think they missed a beat at all.
At all. At all. Like, at all. It was perfect. It was perfect to me.
Yeah, I think it really, really fit into what they were doing. Then you go to track 10, It's All Right. Another one that you mentioned, these up-tempo joints, they still, even though they're singing on it, it still has a New Jack Swing kind of feel.
That was New Jack Swingish. That's how it was.
Yep, it was really, really New Jack Swing. A very, you know, a lot of synthesizers, a lot of keyboards. Yep. And but again, even in the music part of it, you're still not losing that Jodeci sound. So I thought that was really, really dope.
Yep, you could definitely turn it on and know that it was them.
Oh, no question. No question. Yep. No question. And then we go to track 11. Treat You Right, which is, you know, kind of like a little play on Treat Her Like She Wanted to Be Treated, from Father MC. So it, you know, it's kind of like an ode to that song or whatever. It would have been dope if they'd have Father MC on it, but you know,
it really would have been. And it is kind of surprising that he didn't make an appearance. I don't think on any of their stuff.
Nah. Not that I can remember. And I mean, that's like I said, that's the first place where I heard them on his joint. And then the album concludes with track 12, Times We Share. Now, this is my favorite up-tempo joint on side B.
Mine too. This is what I listened to right before we had the call. I had this on repeat.
This joint is my favorite.
Happy, feel good, like, oh my god. And again, KC bodied it. It's just like, I don't know how he did it. I don't know how he was so perfect in delivering. That's what it is, delivering the message. Mm-hmm. You know, delivering the way that the song was written. He was so perfect at that. I don't know how he did it.
I don't either. I don't either. This was the perfect ending to the, you know, to the B side, and I thought it was just, like you said, Casey killed it. He killed it all the way. I mean, like, it was nothing. And really, one of the things that I love about this album is that even though it ends, and even as you listen to Times We Share go off, you still kind of want more. And you know that that's it, but you still want more of the album.
Yeah. I mean, all the way through the last 15 seconds of the song, he's singing. You don't want it to stop. It's like you're at a concert, and it's like you just don't want it to end. Nope. That's how good. I still, like I said, I had it on repeat. So for at least two times, I had to get up and dance to it. That's how much I love this song.
Yes, yes.
I was trying to think of like a order, you know what I'm saying? Like, and I'm so bad. Let me tell you, I'm so bad at, this is why I have never done like a music podcast or anything yet, because but I get so conflicted and I get a little bit of anxiety when I'm trying to, you know, like put something in order, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? So like top five songs, like, I'm trying, like, my top five songs. Yeah, so my top five songs on here wouldn't be, even though 1 through 5 was, like, super solid, my top five on here, I don't think I would have You and I. I would exchange that for Times We Share, and I would move around. You know what I'm saying? So, like, because it is one of my favorite songs on this album. I can just listen to it over and over.
Yes.
I really hope, if you're listening to this podcast and you haven't really taken a good listen at this album, just do it. If you still can't get
the podcast, but yeah, definitely listen to that.
Right. Podcast. I mean, if you can't rock with it, I mean, seriously,
you know, I mean, like this, and you don't necessarily have to have been alive in 1991 or subsequently after that to enjoy this album. I mean, like, you know, I hear people, you know, younger folks, Thundercats, sometimes say, "Well, yeah, I just can't listen to that sound. It just doesn't appeal to me." And I understand it. I don't necessarily agree with it, but I mean, I wasn't around in the '60s, but I could still rock the Otis Redding. You know, I mean, it is, music is music. So. But yeah, this album, like I said, incredible, incredible, incredible. Is there any song on here that you don't like? I'm pretty sure I know the answer, but is there any song here that you don't like?
No, there's not. I like every single song on here. Again, of course, some more than others, but I'm going to let it play. Like, even, you know, I don't have to hit the actual button to fast forward anymore or rewind anymore, but I let it play. Again, like I said, I've run to this. How long is this album? Like an hour?
Running time is right at an hour.
Yeah, so I've put in a good 5 miles to this, and have been, it helped me, you know, because, mm-hmm. you know, sometimes you need something. So sometimes I listen to podcasts, sometimes I listen to music. And like, I don't even know why I was in a Jodeci mood, but I was like, I'm about to listen to this forever my life. That it was going to get me through my run. And it did. I did not have to. I even kind of remember like where I was with some of the songs. You know what I'm saying? Like,
wow.
You know, like I can remember like kind of where I was. So yeah. And I'll do it again. You know, I'll do it again. I know there's not any that I just don't like.
Okay.
That's very rare for me.
So I gotta ask. Give me your top three songs on this album.
Oh man.
Put them in order.
Okay, so you know number one.
But you know what? I'll give you time to think about it. I'll give you mine.
Okay, go ahead.
Let's see. Probably coming in at number three. I mean, it's no secret, it's all ballads. Probably coming in at number three is, I'm gonna go, I'm Still Waiting. At three, I'll go You and I at two and Stay at one.
I'm going to go. This is so hard.
I know, right? That's why I asked.
I'm going to go Times We Share number three.
Okay. Wow. Impressive.
I'm going to go Times We Share number three, which is why this is so hard.
Of course.
Because you know I'm still waiting as number one.
Yes.
So it's definitely, can I have a tie?
No, you got to do three. There's no such thing as ties on the 12 Kyle podcast. We don't believe in that shit.
well, I have to go with Forever, My Lady.
Good call. Good call.
It's really a tie between that and Stay. But if I had to pick one or the other, I'm going to have to pick Forever, My Lady.
Okay.
And Stay is my jam.
No doubt. Same here. Before we get out of here, I gotta, let's get some final thoughts on this album. I think I really don't really know what else more to say, to those of you listening. If you haven't heard this album, please check it out. It is definitely worth it. If you listen and you don't like it, hit me up and tell me why, because I don't. Yeah, I don't think you can listen to it and not like it. But I just want people to understand, like, this album, it resonates with people. And obviously, you see it resonates with me and Autumn, because it's, as I mentioned earlier, it's feel good music. It's good music. And it's music that, whatever you're going through, Autumn mentioned, playing it while she's running. You can play when you work out. You can play when you're chilling in your car. You can play when you're about to go to sleep. You can play when you have someone over, kicking it, winding down, whatever the case may be. It's a great album. I implore anyone listening to check it out. What about you, Autumn? Any final thoughts on it?
We've said it 37 times already. Like this, it just. Again, in any time that you can listen to an album from, back when, or whenever, let's just say 10 plus years ago, 15 mm-hmm. years ago, and you can remember where you were.
Yes.
You can remember, just like we sat here and talked through the whole entire scene for us, all the way down to the clothing, to the reasons we played it. Anytime that it's going to stick with you, and that for you is a great album. And I know that a lot of us don't see eye to eye on music.
Of course, it's subjective.
Yeah. And which is fine. Which is 100% okay. I'm judging you if you don't like this, though. let me just put that out there. There's judgment. I was going to say you'll get a pass if you were like born at a certain time, but you don't even get a pass. Like I can't even give you a pass. So yes, I'm judging you, but that really is, excuse me, my final thought. It's just, it was such a great body of music. Mm-hmm. Like collectively, it was, you don't even get albums now that have five strong hits like hits. Not, and I'm not just saying like, oh, we just like, me and you could have sat here and listened to this album and we loved the whole album, but it wasn't hit for everybody mm-hmm. else. This, at least five, at the very least five of the 12 tracks were hit.
Yeah,
big hit.
Hands down.
So, and you don't get that anymore. You just don't. And I don't really care about the whole, it's because, streaming and all that. I know that numbers matter and all that good stuff, but you knew people talked about this. people talked about this music. You know what I'm saying? It was a conversation. If y'all went to the arcade or the bowling alley or wherever after school, cheerleading practice, whatever, you talked about this album. It just seemed so perfect. It was perfect to me.
Yeah, I agree. And I think this podcast is a testament as to how it resonates with not just us two as fans, but just resonates with people in general. I mean, I broke it down as far as how they were still releasing songs a year later. That says a lot in a time. Songs to resonate, and this group still resonates. I think it always will, because it just represents just a great level of music. And again, the same about it ain't just regular typical BS. It's got some meaning behind it, and if you've been through some things, probably.
Yep. And I'm honestly I'm waiting on a biopic. Like, can we get a Jodeci?
Boys kind of struggled a little bit.
They did. I feel like it could be something. It doesn't have to be.
I don't even know if they'll actually come back and make another album. If they did, I'm cool. I got this.
I would like to see them. Oh, yeah, okay. They come here, because if they come anywhere, they're going to come here. So, I'll be tweeting. Like, we going to see Jodeci. Let's go. All right, so I am, like you said, Autumn the Aries, and you can catch my podcast. I'm doing a lot better at being consistent and dropping them on Fridays. They drop on Fridays at midnight. You can find it on all social media on all podcast platforms, including iHeartRadio, Spotify, wherever you listen to your podcast. And you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Autumn the Airy. So Autumn like fall. the Airy. on Twitter and Instagram. And I do have a page on Facebook, and it's at Lit, L-I-T, Life, L-I-F-E, podcast. I do also have a YouTube channel, and that's at Autumn the Aries as well. And I have a website, www.autumnthearies.com, and my email is autumnthearies@gmail. So it's all the same.
And she's got a TV show. She's everywhere.
Right. I'm everywhere. So feel free to hit me up. I'm always looking to talk to people. I can't wait for you guys to hear this so we can see what the feedback is going to be and how you guys feel about Jodeci Forever My Lady, and if I'm going to have to block you or not. So I'm excited about that.
People who listen to this podcast, they know if we're talking music, that it's something dope. We ain't talking about no wax shit, that's for sure.
I'm just anyway.
But I gotta
awesome. I'm so glad you had me on here.
I'm glad you hit me up, because we have been talking about collaborating and doing something. And so this was perfect for me, because this right up my alley. Anytime as you guys know, I love to talk music, but when you get a chance to talk about, cause I planned it, I knew I was going to do this podcast, but until you had said something to me about it, I was like, shit, I can do it by myself, because I it didn't matter to me one way or the other. This podcast is going to get done, but I definitely want to thank you for coming on, and I appreciate it. As I mentioned, and again, I'm not blessed with one of my favorite podcasts, the Lit Life podcast. Like I said, Autumn hasn't been doing this long, but she sounds like she has, and she has a lot of fun. And you get something out of it. I think I speak for Autumn when I say this, as podcasters, that's what we want people to do. We want people to get something from whatever it is that we're talking about. Even if you're talking about, you know, a frog on the ground, you know, whatever you're talking about, you want the people that, you know, to feel like they're getting something from it. So we definitely feel like you can get something from this podcast. Again, if you haven't listened to Forever My Lady, the album, go check it out. If you haven't heard it in a while, go check it out as well. And, you know, let us know what you think. So,
know what your favorite track is. We want to know what your favorite track is on this album.
Oh yeah, definitely. By all means, let us know what your favorite track is on the album, because that's very important. So that's gonna do it for us. So for my girl Arta Aries, I'm your boy 12 Kyle. We'll catch you guys on the next go round. 5 G's.